This video is concerning intellectual theology and the Holy Spirit's gift to the church of speaking in other tongues. You, child of God, be the judge between us. How can this be true?
It would be for the purpose of communicating God's word with a person of another language.
And also this be true.
For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit.
I am making this video considering that most Christians have the wisdom to judge the scriptures for themselves and not be carried away by every wind of doctrine. Over the last few years, I have posted several very productive videos concerning the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of speaking in other tongues. The Lord Jesus Christ is the baptizer in the Holy Spirit. So many listeners prayed with me and received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of other tongues. This was testified to in the many comments. There were several comments from the anti-tongues Christians, especially those students of the intellectual theology. You are the jury. You weigh the discussion and the scriptures and decide right from wrong. However, I depend on the Holy Spirit to speak to you personally and give you wisdom, knowledge, and understanding concerning the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our teacher, and we all need to remain teachable and request that the Holy Spirit would teach us the word of truth. We are ready to be taught now, so we can pray in agreement and request that the Holy Spirit teach us spiritual things. Just follow me as we pray in agreement. Father God, that's right, follow me. Father God, we ask you now to teach us the things of the Lord Jesus Christ according to your holy word. Anoint us with your Holy Spirit and give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Teach us about the gifts of speaking in other tongues and clear up our misunderstandings. We agree in asking you for this revelation knowledge, so we too agree as in touching, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Proverbs 18:17 says, "The first to present his case seems right till another comes forward and questions him."
The following is a presentation of God Questions Ministries.
What is systematic theology? Systematic refers to something being put into a system. Systematic theology is, therefore, the division of theology into systems that explain its various areas. For example, many books of the Bible give information about the angels. No one book gives all the information about the angels. Systematic theology takes all the information about angels from all the books of the Bible and organizes it into a system called angelology. This is what systematic theology is all about, organizing the teachings of the Bible into categorical systems. Pneumatology is the study of God the Holy Spirit. Systematic theology is an important tool in helping us to understand and teach the Bible in an organized manner. In addition to systematic theology, there are other ways that theology can be divided.
Intellectual theology is just a name that I made up to refer to those people whom the Apostle Paul was prophesying about in his second letter to Timothy, chapter 3.
Chapter 3. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Avoid such people. For among them are those who creep into households and capture weak women, burdened with sins, and led astray by various passions, always learning and never able to arrive at a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so these men also oppose the truth, men corrupted in mind and disqualified regarding the faith. But they will not get very far, for their folly will be plain to all, as was that of those two men.
No matter what method of theology is studied, What is important is that theology is being studied.
God Questions Ministry seeks to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ by providing biblical answers to today's questions. Online at gotquestions.org.
What is the gift of speaking in tongues? The first occurrence of speaking in tongues occurred on the day of Pentecost in Acts 2, verses 1 through 4. The apostles went out and shared the gospel with the crowds, speaking to them in their own languages. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues, Acts 2, verse 11. The Greek word translated tongues literally means languages. Therefore, the gift of tongues is speaking in a language a person does not know in order to minister to someone who does speak that language.
Wow. Let's replay that last 12 seconds and look at the assumptions made when the speaker jumps to a conclusion that is not scripturally accurate.
Therefore, the gift of tongues is speaking in a language a person does not know in order to minister to someone who does speak that language.
Hold on.
For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit.
Let's find out what Acts chapter 2 actually says and not just swallow the summary of this intellectual theology.
Chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes, and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, What does this mean? But others mocking said, They are filled with new wine. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel.
Now, let's look carefully at what the Bible actually says as the God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven describe what they hear.
We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, What does this mean?
They said, We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, What does this mean? What they did not say was that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ was preached to them in their own tongue. They did not say it because the saints in the upper room were full of the Holy Spirit and were praising God and the gift of tongues as given by the Holy Spirit. Peter came outside and preached the gospel in Hebrew, and there was no mention of him or anyone else preaching the gospel in an unknown tongue. Let everything be established with two or three witnesses.
For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit.
There is nowhere in the entire New Testament that any apostle, any prophet, any preacher, teacher, or saint preached the gospel to anyone in any nation that they traveled to in the gift of speaking in other tongues. This is an unscriptural assumption made by this intellectual theologians, and by teaching that assumption, they have destroyed the faith of many saints whom would love to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gift of tongues as given by the Holy Spirit. Let's continue analyzing the statement on tongues.
The Greek word translated tongues literally means languages. Therefore, the gift of tongues is speaking in a language a person does not know in order to minister to someone who does speak that language. In 1 Corinthians chapters 12 through 14, Paul discusses miraculous gifts, saying, "Now, brothers, if I come to you and speak in tongues, what good will I be to you, unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or word of instruction?" 1 Corinthians 14, verse 6. According to the Apostle Paul, and in agreement with the tongues described in Acts, speaking in tongues is valuable to the one hearing God's message in his or her own language, but it is useless to everyone else unless it is interpreted or translated.
Wow! He's saying that the Holy Spirit is giving out a useless gift. Let's hear that again.
But it is useless to everyone else unless it is interpreted or translated.
The Apostle Paul said,
"The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself."
Speaking in tongues builds up or edifies the person speaking in tongues.
A person with a gift of interpreting tongues, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 30, could understand what a tongue speaker was saying, even though he did not know the language that was being spoken. The tongues interpreter would then communicate the message of the tongue speaker to everyone else, so all could understand.
Wow, this guy is wrong again.
A person with a gift of interpreting tongues, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 30, could understand what a tongue speaker was saying, even though he did not know the language that was being spoken.
He has the operation of this gift backwards, but it's real easy to understand. The Corinthians spoke some dialect of the Greek language. The Holy Spirit is the author of the message that is spoken to the Greek Corinthian speaker. The Greek Corinthian speaker spoke out the words he was given in tongues, in a language no one in the congregation could understand. Let's just label the language as Japanese. No one in the congregation could understand Japanese. Someone in the congregation prayed for the interpretation of the message that was given in tongues. The Holy Spirit gave the interpretation to the interpreter in the same dialect of the Greek Corinthian interpreter. In an English-speaking congregation, the Holy Spirit gives the interpretation to the interpreter in their dialect of English. The gift of interpretation of tongues does not mean that a person can interpret tongues. It means that a person can speak out the interpretation by speaking out the words that the Holy Spirit gives him. He does not interpret the Japanese. The Holy Spirit is the author of the message in tongues, and only the Holy Spirit can interpret the message. The gifts of prophecy, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, and so on are very similar, in that the Holy Spirit gives the words in the same dialect of the speaker. When Paul pointed out that prophecy is subject to the spirit of the prophet, he was pointing out that every person remains in control of their own tongue. The Holy Spirit does not move your mouth or force you to say anything. If you have an interpretation or a prophecy, the Holy Spirit will give you the words at your turn and give you the message. The person is not a robot. He can stop or start talking at his own will. He can refuse to give the message. On the day of Pentecost, when the Galileans were worshiping God in tongues, the Holy Spirit gave them the words to say. They did not understand these words of worship, but the Holy Spirit used these words as a sign to the unbelieving Jews that were visiting from the foreign lands. Various visiting Jews heard the Galileans praising God in their own home languages. In the Old Testament, God gave the prophet Balaam a sign when his donkey was talking, a sign that he ignored. On the day of Pentecost, 3,000 were saved because they believed the sign of tongues and Peter's preaching. But even today, most unbelievers ignore the sign of tongues. If a person in the congregation should hear tongues in their own language, it is likely a sign from the Holy Spirit to the unbelievers.
For this reason, anyone who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret what he says. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 13. Paul's conclusion regarding tongues that were not interpreted is powerful. But in the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 19. Is the gift of tongues for today? 1 Corinthians 13, verse 8 mentions the gift of tongues ceasing, although it connects the ceasing with the arrival of the perfect in verse 10. Some point to a difference in the tense of the Greek verbs referring to prophecy and knowledge ceasing, and that of tongues being ceased, as evidence for tongues ceasing before the arrival of the perfect. While possible, this is not explicitly clear from the text. Some also point to passages such as Isaiah 28 verse 11 and Joel 2 verses 28 and 29 as evidence that speaking in tongues was a sign of God's oncoming judgment. 1 Corinthians 14 verse 22 describes tongues as a sign to unbelievers. According to this argument, the gift of tongues was a warning to the Jews that God was going to judge Israel for rejecting Jesus Christ as Messiah. Therefore, when God did in fact judge Israel with the destruction of Jerusalem by the Romans in AD 70, the gift of tongues would no longer serve its intended purpose. While this view is possible, the primary purpose of tongues being fulfilled does not necessarily demand its cessation. Scripture does not conclusively assert that the gift of speaking in tongues has ceased. At the same time, if the gift of speaking in tongues were active in the church today, it would be performed in agreement with Scripture. It would be in a real and intelligible language, 1 Corinthians 14 verse 10. It would be for the purpose of communicating God's word with a person of another language, Acts 2 verses 6 through 12.
Wow! How can this be true?
It would be for the purpose of communicating God's word with a person of another language.
And also this be true.
For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit.
It would be in agreement with the command God gave through the Apostle Paul, if anyone speaks in a tongue, two or at the most three should speak, one at a time, and someone must interpret. If there is no interpreter, the speaker should keep quiet in the church and speak to himself and God. 1 Corinthians 14 verses 27 and 28.
Well, golly gee, I can't pray in tongues the entire 3 hours a week I'm in church. So that only leaves me 165 hours that I can pray in tongues in the week.
It would also be in accordance with 1 Corinthians 14 verse 33, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. God most definitely can give a person the gift of speaking in tongues to enable him or her to communicate with a person who speaks another language. The Holy Spirit is sovereign in the dispersion of the spiritual gifts, 1 Corinthians 12 verse 11. Just imagine how much more productive missionaries could be if they did not have to go to language school and were instantly able to speak to people in their own language. However, God does not seem to be doing this. Tongues does not seem to occur today in the manner that it did in the New Testament. Despite the fact that it would be immensely useful, the vast majority of believers who claim to practice the gift of speaking in tongues do not do so in agreement with the scriptures I've just mentioned. These facts lead to the conclusion that the gift of tongues has ceased, or is at least a rarity in God's plan for the church today.
God Questions Ministry seeks to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ by providing biblical answers to today's questions. Online at gotquestions.org.
Wow, I just had to say that again. Intellectual theologians have built a straw man and burned it before our eyes. By their definitions, they have created a gift of tongues that does not exist, and then use unscriptural logic to show that it is unnecessary and may have ceased to exist, while in the same time ignoring what Paul wrote. You have heard from the intellectual theologians. Now listen to what Apostle Paul actually said to the unruly saints of the Church of Corinth while trying to establish discipline in that church.
Chapter 14. Pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit.
This manifestation of the gift of tongues is the prayer gift. It is a manifestation where men do not speak to men, but only speak to God. Obviously, intellectual theology talked many saints out of receiving a priceless gift of prayer, which is the work of the Holy Spirit himself. The Holy Spirit speaks the words to our human spirit. Then our human spirit speaks them out in a divinely led prayer to Almighty God. Since we do not know what we are praying, it bypasses our limited knowledge and bypasses all of our doubt and unbelief and things learned wrong, but originates from the infinite faith and infinite knowledge of the Holy Spirit himself. The Lord Jesus Christ went to the cross and made intercession for us before we knew that we needed a Savior. Likewise, the Holy Spirit is making intercession for us before we know what we need to pray.
For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit. On the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. Now I want you all to speak in tongues, but even more, to prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets, so that the church may be built up. Now, brothers, if I come to you speaking in tongues, how will I benefit you unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or teaching? If even lifeless instruments, such as the flute or the harp, do not give distinct notes, how will anyone know what is played? And if the bugle gives an indistinct sound, who will get ready for battle? So with yourselves, if with your tongue you utter speech that is not intelligible, how will anyone know what is said? For you will be speaking into the air. There are doubtless many different languages in the world, and none is without meaning. But if I do not know the meaning of the language, I will be a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker a foreigner to me. So with yourselves, since you are eager for manifestations of the Spirit, strive to excel in building up the church. Therefore, one who speaks in a tongue should pray for the power to interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing with my mind also. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying? For you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue.
The Lord Jesus Christ is both prophet and priest. A priest intercedes for man unto God, and a prophet intercedes for God unto man. The Holy Spirit is interceding for man in the operation of the prayer gift of tongues. The Holy Spirit is interceding for Almighty God in the operation of the gifts of prophecy and the gift of interpretation of tongues. The interpretation of tongues is a manifestation of the message gift of tongues. There is a message to the church in tongues that cannot be understood by anyone. Then the Holy Spirit gives the interpretation to someone. The interpretation is spoken out in the understood language of the congregation, which blesses the congregation. Paul stresses the point that I pray in tongues more than you all, but in the church. Get that? In the church, I would rather speak 5 words in my understanding than 10,000 words in tongues. Many congregations today are manifesting tongues, interpretation, prophecy, all decently and in order. And multiple millions of Christian saints are praying in tongues outside of the church.
I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. In the law it is written, by people of strange tongues and by the lips of foreigners will I speak to this people, and even then they will not listen to me, says the Lord. Thus tongues are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign not for unbelievers, but for believers.
The Apostle Paul just explained that tongues are for sign to unbelievers, as it is written in the law. He's referring to Isaiah 28:11-12. Very well then, with foreign lips and strange tongues, God will speak to this people, to whom he said, this is the resting place. Let the weary rest, and this is the place of repose. But they will not listen. Isaiah prophesies that tongues will be a sign of God's call to repentance to the Jews. But the Jews will not believe the sign and repent and return back to God. This is a manifestation of the sign gift of tongues. We saw a manifestation of this gift on the day of Pentecost, when Jews from every nation heard Galileans praising God in languages that they did not know. 3,000 were saved that day, but the sign was to the entire nation of Jews to repent. Today, there are churches in Israel as well as the rest of the world that manifest the gift of speaking in other tongues. It is still a sign, and the Jews still will not believe.
Thus, tongues are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign not for unbelievers, but for believers. If, therefore, the whole church comes together and all speak in tongues, and outsiders or unbelievers enter, will they not say that you are out of your minds? But if all prophesy, and an unbeliever or outsider enters, he is convicted by all, he is called to account by all. The secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so, falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. What then, brothers? When you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. If any speak in a tongue, let there be only two, or at most three, and each in turn, and let someone interpret. But if there is no one to interpret, let each of them keep silent in church and speak to himself and to God. Let two or three prophets speak, and let the others weigh what is said. If a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, so that all may learn and all be encouraged, and the spirits of prophets are subject to prophets. For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. So, my brothers, earnestly desire to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues. But all things should be done decently and in order.
The Apostle Paul sums up this message on the subject of keeping order in the church. Earnestly desire to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues. But all things should be done decently and in order. Many congregations today are manifesting tongues, interpretation, and prophecy, all decently and in order. And multiple millions of Christian saints are praying in tongues outside of the church on a daily basis. And I am sure that Satan has spoken to at least some of you saints and reminded you that the Bible says tongues shall cease. But that's probably the only part of the message you remember. So bear with me for a moment and crush Satan's head with the truth.
Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. For now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, but the greatest of these is love.
Tongues and prophecy shall cease when the Lord Jesus Christ returns. Tongues and prophecy are gifts of the Holy Spirit. They are unearned and undeserved. They are gifts from God. We shall be judged by the fruit of the Spirit, and the greatest of these fruits is love, and not by the gifts of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit's gift of tongues has not ceased and will not cease until Jesus returns. Tongues is not a gift of preaching in a language that you do not know. That preaching manifestation of tongues has not been recorded in the Scriptures in any place. The Holy Spirit leads you in prayer with tongues in a language that you do not understand. And Almighty God wants you to pray in tongues. That is the purpose of the gift. It is the Lord Jesus Christ that is your baptizer in the Holy Spirit. Regardless of the righteousness of the pastor praying for you, it is the blood of Jesus that has made atonement for you. This is also regardless of whether you have stopped gossiping or smoking or any of those other naughty habits that you're struggling with. When you become a born-again Christian, you are a sinner that Jesus has washed in his blood. What got you that born-again experience was not your own righteousness, but as a gift from God, unearned and undeserved. You simply receive Jesus by faith. Your sins are forgiven. Your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You were not required to prove yourself holy or deserving before you received the gift of salvation. So make up your mind now. There is no more payment needed or wanted for you to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of speaking in other tongues. You're a blood-bought child of Almighty God. You do not receive the Holy Spirit because you're doing things right, and you're not rejected by the Holy Spirit because you're doing things wrong. It is the blood on the altar in heaven. Remember Jesus' letter to the church. Jesus is standing at your door knocking. And you must just open and allow him to come in. He does not choose you because of your personal righteousness, which, by the way, is just filthy rags before the Holy God. There is no waiting. There is no fasting. There is no praising. There is no giving. There is no begging. There is no tarrying. There is no confessing. There is no other religious practice or religious exercise that will convince the Lord Jesus Christ to baptize you in the Holy Spirit and give you the gift of tongues. He has already said yes. He cannot say no. Almighty God sees the blood on the altar in heaven and said yes. He cannot say no to you because of the blood. The answer has been yes since the day of Pentecost almost 2,000 years ago. Can you really picture the Holy Spirit, whom is always in total agreement with the Father, telling the Father, "Yes, I see the blood on the altar, but I have chosen not to give this particular Christian the gifts of the Spirit." No, I'm not mocking the Holy Spirit here. I'm telling you, maybe what you think to be true does not make sense. God did not single you out to not give you tongues or any other gift. The evidence of God's love is the blood. The evidence of God's covenant is the blood. The evidence of your salvation is the blood. The evidence of God's will is the blood. The evidence God wants you to receive the gifts of the Spirit is the blood. The purchase price was paid. The packaging was paid. The handling was paid. The shipping was paid. And Jesus is knocking on your door trying to deliver the gifts to you. Open the door to the Lord Jesus Christ. You can pray right now. Whatever you ask the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, it will be done for you. If you wish, I can lead you in prayer right now. Just pray with me, but put your faith in God to work for you. Almighty God. Yeah. Just go ahead, pray with me, pray after me. Almighty God, forgive me my every sin, my every trespass, all of my doubt and unbelief, all the things I've learned wrong, forgive me. Wash me in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Baptize me now in the Holy Spirit and give me the gifts of the Spirit. Give me the gift of speaking in other tongues now, and help me to speak the words now. I open the door to you, Lord Jesus, and receive these gifts from you as done in the holy name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, child of God, the Holy Spirit is speaking to your spirit, not to your ear. Just speak out the words he's saying to you. Don't repeat after me, but I'm going to pray for you. Just speak out whatever he's saying to you. Whatever those words are, just worship him, praise him, speak it out. The word says you are baptized in the Holy Spirit. Do not defy the word of God. Just speak it out. There's a pillar of fire on you now. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Glory and honor and praise be unto you, Lamb that was slain. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.